hey, AVCon was on a few weeks ago now. I travelled across from Melbourne and I spent a lot of time in the indie games room. This year I had over 50 games in there. I got to see about 10 of them and I wanted to chat about them with you guys. I'm going to be including as many links as I can for the games and the developers in the description, so please check it out. And I haven't listed these in any particular order except how I played them over the weekend. Okay, so here we go. Exo One is by Expletive. I played Exo One last year at AVCon, and in the last year it's been shown at EGX Resd in the UK and it's had a successful Kickstarter and I was actually a backer for it. It's an exoplanetary exploration game, which is really fun to say for this video. You fly around as this spherical alien or human spaceship and just float and glide and roll around all the different planets. The gravity-based movement system is you turn on or off gravity, so when you're going down slopes you turn it on to get a lot of speed, and when you go up the other side you let it go and you can jump and float and glide, and it's just really, really peaceful and just really beautiful. The planets that you go on are really interesting to look at, and there's weather, and it's just nice. It kind of brings about that, I don't know if you guys have ever played Motocross Madness. It's a game back from when I was a kid, sometime in the 90s, and one of the gameplay options was to sort of just run around and explore all these sand dunes, and Exo One kind of reminds me of that sort of gameplay, even though it's also totally different. I guess I mean it's just one of those things where you see something in the distance and I just want to go and look at it, and trying to get the most height in a jump is really fun, and seeing how far you can glide and that sort of thing. It's, you just sort of make your own challenges and make your own way in the game. I've never played a game that makes me feel so calm. It's got a really hypnotic soundtrack. I think it's all distorted guitar noises, and it's just really, like, it puts you in another world. And I know that sounds cliche, but it's kind of exactly what it does for me. I just get to float around in space and look at things, and that's just kind of amazing. Because I played the game last year, I was looking at things that had changed over the last 12 months. I think my favorite thing was the added controller support. Last year it was just the keyboard and the mouse, and I'm a console player predominantly, so I had a little more difficulty with it. My hands kept slipping off the keys, which is nothing to do with the controls, it's just to do with me and my ineptitude. So the controller was a lot better for me. I found it much easier to play and I got to float around a lot easier, I guess. The only thing I had trouble with was the camera, because I'm one of those weirdos who uses the inverted controls, so up is down for me. So I did a lot of looking into the ground and being like, oh no, I didn't want to look there. I wanted to look at the sky. But I have spoken to the developer online and he says there will be an option to have the inverted camera. So yay for me, when the game comes out, I'll be able to play it and it won't be a problem. It's definitely the kind of game I'd be playing after a crappy day at work, or, you know, I'm feeling kind of stressed or something like that. For me, because it makes me feel so calm, it would definitely be a place I want to go to feel that way again. And I guess if you're into that sort of feeling, or if you're into a game where you get to look at a pretty landscape and explore and like just using movement, because the whole game is based in movement, I think it's something you should check out. Goat Punks is by Studio Canvas. It's a multiplayer King of the Hill style game where you play as goats. It has a super cute 3D animated style, and interestingly enough, unless the developer's friend was lying to me, the developer is actually an animator on Happy Feet, and I think it's kind of cool that background is now transferred into game development. I think it really shows in the art style. It looks absolutely incredible, the worlds look really cool, and the goats are super cute, and I'm just going to keep saying super cute because that's what this game was. And it was so much fun. You play as a goat, but you've also got a choice in the goats that you play as. It's sort of got that Mario Kart thing, you know, you've got all the goats have different skills, so you've got to pick which ones that match your playing style, which you won't know unless you play through a few times. The point of the game is to get to the top of the hill, except everyone else is trying to knock you off the top of the hill, and you've got to get 30 seconds up there all up. When I played it, I think three of us were stuck at 20 seconds for ages, and I think it took us over 6 minutes to finish the round because we all kept knocking each other off and no one could get up there long enough to get to the 30 seconds. So it was really fun. It builds that rivalry when you're playing local co-op, which was really good. So you're getting a bit like nasty on the person who's keeps knocking you down and picks up the chainsaw. It brings out the rager in me just a little bit, even though you're playing as super cute goats. The best thing about this game, it's not the best thing, but a super cool thing that I nerded out about a bit because I'm a graphic designer, was the business cards. They're all character sheets for the different goats. And the first time when I took the card, I got Icy Punk and I went back the next day. I was like, hi, pretty please, can I have the rest of the cards? Because I need to collect them all and frame them and stick them on my wall. GoPunks is actually available on Steam right now, and you can play online multiplayer from there. So definitely have a look and check it out. It's also going to be coming to some consoles soon, I'm pretty sure. It's definitely something you should get if you're looking for couch multiplayer, because it is a lot of fun. The Adventure Pals is by Massive Monster. It's an adventure platformer game featuring a boy, his giraffe, and his pet rock. And the pet rock is what sold me on playing this game in the first place, because I used to have a pet rock as a kid, and I think he was called Pete, and he became a pirate, and I'm not quite sure what happened to him after that, but when I heard the game had a pet rock, I was like, my childhood! And just had to play it. It was being shown at AVCon by the game artist and animator, and it was really cool talking to him about how I think he used Spine was the program to animate it, and he said it's a bit easier where you can draw something and grab the points, and the way it animates is different to other frame-based animating programs. It has a really interesting 2D art style. It's super bright, and it kind of reminds me a little bit of Adventure Time, but more shiny, if that makes sense. It's also got a bit of a Banjo-Kazooie vibe, because your giraffe is in your backpack as you go adventuring around. I really enjoyed the platforming, and it's got coin collecting, and there's also collectibles as well, plus there's fights with the enemies, I guess, that turn up, and I didn't get to play it in the demo, but there's also boss fights in it. I really just like the whole vibe of the game, because it literally is the Adventure Pals. You feel like you are off going on an adventure. There is a bit of an overworld map kind of thing as you travel between levels, so you get to actually move around the map as you go from one place to the other, and it's not just like Super Mario where, you know, there's the lines and it's like, oh, here's point A, and Mario went da-da-da-da-da-da, and there's point B. It's you get to sort of gallivant around with your giraffe, and that was a really fun way to move about the levels, because it brings about that whole adventure feeling again. It also has local multiplayer, which drops a second character into the game, so you can jump around and have adventures together as well, and I really like how much the game focuses on that whole friendship aspect. You can really feel the consideration that the developers have put into garnering that feeling. For me, it's definitely one I want to pick up, because I'm always looking for more local co-op games to play with my husband, because I feel like there's not enough games out there that we can play together that are different to, you know, racing or first-person shooters or something like that. Murder at the Dinner Table is by Luckstorm. It's an investigative puzzle game, and it was actually developed by 4 high school students. It was originally made for a game jam with the theme of one room, and it's now been expanded into a full game. It's set during the Great Depression in America, and there's a lot of murdering going on. The gameplay kind of reminded me of Sleuth, which is an old DOS game I had as a kid, plus Wink Murder, if that makes a bit of sense. Probably not. I guess it's, you're in a room, people are dying, and more people are dying as you go, and I think that's where the Wink Murder aspect comes into it. It's less Cluedo, even though you've got to solve the case, and more a race against time. As you play, the anxiety level in the room goes up, and if you theft goes too high, you fail the level, as well as if you get, you know, the wrong guy accused. Trying to solve who the murderer is also encouraged using pen and paper, because you're given so many clues from the body, and then when you talk to people in the crowd, and you've got to sort of look at this list of characteristics and write them all down and figure out through process of elimination who the murderer is. And I just love when I have to use pen and paper. I had the same feeling when I got to do that to solve problems in Eyes of Aura, and I really like it again in this game. It also has a fun little interrogation minigame between the levels where you've got to try and get the murderer to confess. I liked that break in the puzzles as well. The difficulty scale goes up through adding more potential suspects. And by that I mean, I guess your pool of suspects is wider, so then it's not just, oh, there's 8 people in the room, and so you can solve it quite quickly when there's 16, 20 plus people, and suddenly more than one person is wearing glasses, and more than one person is a doctor, and that sort of thing. It means you've got to wait longer, or you've got to take a risk and accuse early before you know all the facts, because if you wait too long, you're going to fail the level because too many people died, and you know, not having people die is generally a pretty good thing. The game had an overarching plot as well, which is sort of introduced in bits and pieces between the levels. I didn't get to solve it all, and it definitely intrigued me because, you know, why are all these murders happening? Why am I the detective happening to be around all these murders? Are they targeted to me? Are they targeting my family? And I liked that that was included, because it just moves it beyond just, of Pick the Murderer. The developers are also entering it into the Screen It competition at Acme, and I wish them the best of luck with that. You can also check out the game for yourself from itch.io. BallisticNG is by Neognosis. I'm sorry, I can't say your studio name. It's an anti-gravity racing game, which I was absolutely terrible at. It's inspired by games like Wipeout and F-Zero, and I hadn't played either of them either, so I had no idea what to expect when I played this game. Even though I haven't played those games, I could definitely tell the nostalgia vibe for the PS1 through playing it. It even had that sort of glitch thing that the hardware in the PS1 did, which was really cool to see they've gone to that effort to really recreate that feel of the older games. It definitely needed a lot more finesse than I have to play it. I'm shocking at racing games anyway. The most I play is Mario Kart and maybe occasionally Forza against my husband, and I'm not very good at Forza. Mario Kart I'm pretty good at, but then that's not really a simulation game. It's definitely the kind of game that rewards hard work to perfect the courses. You know, if you know where to go to lean into that corner and where to drift, you're gonna do a lot better than I had. It has difficulty levels, and I was on the easiest one, and the best I could do was third, which I was pretty chuffed with, actually. The physics in the game were really cool because that had to be considered, because it's anti-grav ships that are flying, racing, gliding. I don't know what you call it, if it's an anti-gravity thing, and I don't know if it's magnets or how, you know, theoretically it would work, but it meant there was a lot of slip when you're racing, which I thought was really cool that they've actually put thought into how these kinds of things would work. And I also got told, I didn't see this myself, but the tracks aren't static, so there was power-ups as you race as well, and one of them actually vibrates the track and things like that, and I like that it's not just this one solid thing beneath you, that they're taking advantage of the anti-gravity situation to use power-ups that do that kind of thing. Speaking of the tracks and the ships, the online community can actually also build their own custom ones, which I think is a really neat way to get people involved in the game. And really cool at the table, they had these papercraft ships as well that they built. There was only two because they realized after building those two it takes ages, and they didn't want to spend all their time doing that, which is fair enough. In local multiplayer, you can play split screen or dual screen, so one person on each screen, which is really cool, and it's up to two people, but online you can race with up to 16. I think if you like racing games that really require that bit more finesse than what I have, you should have a look at it. If you liked those Wipeout games or F-Zero, check it out. It's available on Steam, I should say that. So that's the first five games that I played. I'm going to split this video into two parts just to keep the length down. Did you guys play any of those? I'd love to hear about them, or any of the other games that you got to play, and I will see you in the next one. Bye!